I wanted to have a focus on how the pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic properties of the drugs can influence your clinical understanding of the SSRIs. So first, let's just take a look at the six SSRIs that we're going to go over here. We've got sertraline, which is Zoloft, escitalopram, which is Lexapro, fluoxetine, which is Prozac, paroxetine, which is Paxil, citalopram, which is Celexa, and fluvoxamine, which is Luvox. And the common denominator between all these drugs is they block the transporter that reuptakes serotonin, which is called SERT. And the previous generation of antidepressants would block a whole host of receptors. So the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors got their names because they block SERT more selectively. And in this video, we'll learn that these drugs have affinity for other receptors, but it's just much less so compared to the older drugs. So let's go one by one and review the differences between these medications. So to start, let's get a closer look at sertraline, which is the brand name Zoloft. So for each of these drugs, I want to go into the other receptors that these drugs hit, the FDA approval that these drugs have, and then the off-label use for these drugs. And one thing I really want to focus on this video is how you can use the other receptors that the drugs hit to remember the differences that exist between the drugs. And I want to emphasize that typically it hits these receptors at the higher doses, so it might not even be clinically relevant in all cases. But knowing the different receptors helps me organize the different nuances of the drugs. So the other receptors that Zoloft hits are DAT and sigma-1. It's FDA approved for depression, OCD in kids over 6, panic disorder, PTSD, PMDD, and social anxiety. And it's used off-label for generalized anxiety disorder and other anxiety disorders. So Zoloft blocks DAT, and that's the dopamine active transporter, which is responsible for the reuptake of dopamine. So we know if you block that, you're going to have an increase in dopamine. And it's unclear if Zoloft has enough blockade for clinical relevance. But again, it's still really useful for me to remember the unique clinical properties of Zoloft. So the DAT blockade helps me to remember that it's mildly activating and works best for patients with atypical depression. And just a quick reminder, atypical depression is depression that has weight gain, hypersomnia, interpersonal rejection sensitivity, and mood reactivity. So Zoloft is the SSRI that works best for patients with hypersomnia, low energy, and mood reactivity. The downside, or upside depending on how you view it, is it can cause some overactivation in patients, especially in patients with panic disease. Zoloft is also an antagonist at sigma-1, and we don't really know what sigma is involved in. It's kind of called the sigma enigma, so it's unclear, but it might help with the anxiety effects and the psychotic depression, where Zoloft seems to have an advantage. And I can't help but notice that all the SSRIs that are particularly good for OCD also block the sigma-1 receptor. In terms of the side effects Zoloft is particularly known for, it's diarrhea, or basically just any of the GI side effects. And this is easy to remember by calling it squirtraline. Now, all things considered, Lexapro and Zoloft are probably first-line SSRIs for most conditions that we treat. And that's because they have the best balance of side effects and cost and drug-drug interactions and efficacy. So Zoloft has minimal drug-drug interactions at doses less than 150 milligrams. But at doses greater than 150 milligrams, it's a moderate inhibitor of the 2D6. Now, also, Zoloft has the best safety record in cardiovascular disease, and it's proven safe in patients with a recent myocardial infarction. It's also one of the only SSRIs that has no issues with prolactin, and that helps me to remember it's got the most evidence base for use during breastfeeding when necessary. So if I had to summarize Zoloft in one line, I'd say it's an SSRI that works well with atypical depression given its blockade at DAT. It's got an excellent safety profile with minimal interactions at doses less than 150 milligrams, and the one downside is that it can cause a side effect of diarrhea. So now the next antidepressant I want to take a closer look at is escitalopram, which is Lexapro. And the other receptors it hits is basically none. So it's basically the purest SSRI, so it just hits SERT. It's FDA approved for depression, including children over 12, and for generalized anxiety disorder. It's used off-label for OCD, social anxiety, panic disorder, and PMDD. So escitalopram gets its name from being the S enantiomer of citalopram. And just as a quick review, enantiomers are molecules that are mirror images of one another, similar to your left hand and right hand. And R and S is the naming convention that describes the spatial arrangement of the atoms in the molecule. And R and S come out of the Latin terms for right and left. Sinistra originally meant left, but took on meanings of evil and unlucky. So if you were left-handed or sinister, you were associated with evil. And I'm actually left-handed, so this naming convention is very upsetting to me. So anyway, when drugs exist as enantiomers, usually only one of them has the physiological effects, and the other one tends to be less active or inactive, or it produces adverse effects. And so that's kind of the situation for citalopram, where the S enantiomer is the one that has the effects that we want. So I think it's pretty cute and subtle that they throw the S's and the R's and the D's in the name of the drugs. So other drugs that do that is azopaclone, which is Lunesta, And there's also a drug called zopiclone, so that's the S enantiomer. Then there's esketamine, which is the S for ketamine. Then we know there's modafinil, which is Provigil, versus R-modafinil, that's Nuvigil. And then there's stimulants that refer to the DL naming convention. So there's like amphetamine and dextroamphetamine, or methylphenidate and dexmethylphenidate. So moving on, we know that escitalopram is modestly superior to citalopram in efficacy and tolerability. And I'll go more into that in the next slide. So the fact that Lexapro is like a more selective version of another one of the SSRIs helps me to keep in mind that Lexapro is the most selective SSRI. So it's basically only hitting SERT. So that helps me to remember that it's one of the medications that's the best tolerated. It's got the fewest side effects. It probably has the least amount of insomnia, and it's got a linear dose proportional pharmacokinetics. And it probably has the fastest onset of action for any of the SSRIs. But just as a caveat to this, these medications interact differently with everyone, so some patients will have wildly different experiences. But as I said before, all things considered, I think that Lexapro and Zoloft are probably the first-line SSRIs. Other important things to know for Lexapro is it's approved in kids 12 and older, so only Lexapro and Prozac are approved for children. And just a heads up, for Prozac, it's approved for kids 8 and older. And these next two apply to the PRAMs, so citalopram and escitalopram, and that's that they're known to mildly raise the QTC, and they're typically preferred for the medically ill and the elderly because of the least amount of drug interactions. The other thing about Lexapro is that I have this theory that Lexapro is what flipped Kanye into mania. So from his 2016 album, The Life of Pablo, you can hear this line. You ain't never seen nothing crazy then, this when he off his Lexapro. And then in 2018, he drops the Yay album, which the cover says, I hate being bipolar, it's awesome. So that's why I have that theory. So if I had to use a one-liner for Lexapro, I'd say it's the purest SSRI, it's got the fewest side effects, the least interactions, it's approved in kids 12 and older, and the downside is it can have a very mild QTC increase. So the next SSRI we're going to take a closer look at is citalopram, or Celexa. And the other receptor it hits is histamine. It's FDA approved for depression, and it's used off-label for OCD, social anxiety, GAD, panic disorder, and PMDD. So as I was saying before, citalopram is the racemic mixture of escitalopram and R-citalopram. So I like to think of the R enantiomer as the problematic enantiomer in this mix. So I conceptualize Celexa as sort of escitalopram with a few additional problems. And the additional problems is that it causes a worse QTC prolongation. The FDA said you shouldn't exceed 40 milligrams per day of citalopram because it doesn't improve effectiveness and it's a higher QTC risk. And the FDA also says don't exceed 20 milligrams per day for patients that are greater than 60 years old, are taking a CYP2C19 inhibitor such as cimetidine, and people who are poor CYP2C19 metabolizers. And the other problematic thing that the R enantiomer causes is the mild antihistaminergic properties. And also the R enantiomer can interfere with the S enantiomer, so that means that it can alter the dose effect curve. So because the R enantiomer interacts with the S enantiomer, it makes it so it kind of has a leveling off of efficacy, which I sort of remember through the FDA's recommendations on dosing limitations. And the last point I want to make is it has favorable findings in the elderly. So if I had to give Celexa one-liner, I'd say it's basically escitalopram plus a problematic enantiomer that has a little antihistamine and can cause more QTC problems. So the next SSRI that I want to take a closer look at is fluoxetine, or Prozac.
Here we go. Here comes the Prozac.
So the other receptors that it hits are 5-HT2C and NET. It's FDA approved for depression, including in kids 8 and older, and it's FDA approved for OCD, including kids 7 and older, as well as for panic disorder and bulimia. And then for PMDD, it's called Seraphim. It's used off-label for PTSD and social anxiety. So 5-HT2C blockade increases dopamine and norepinephrine. And for some reason, the fact that it hits this receptor helps me to remember that it's approved for bulimia. And it's the only SSRI that's approved for bulimia. But here, the doses tend to be a bit higher, like 60 milligrams. Also, Prozac typically has the lowest risk for weight gain. For some people, it even causes early weight loss, but that weight loss typically doesn't last. And another thing that this receptor helps me to keep in mind is that Prozac is commonly added to Zyprexa and can be used to treat the depression in bipolar disorder. And both these drugs hit the 5-HT2C receptor. Prozac also blocks NET, which is the norepinephrine transporter, which is responsible for the reuptake of norepinephrine. And this helps me to remember that Prozac can be activating, so it can be especially helpful in patients who could use a little bit of activation. The downside being that Prozac isn't particularly great for anxiety, and it can worsen insomnia or agitation or even panic attacks. The other property of Prozac that's worth remembering is that it has a long half-life. So the half-life is 5 days for fluoxetine and then 9 days for its metabolite norfluoxetine. And this is why it's got the lowest risk of discontinuation syndrome, because it's kind of got a naturally built-in taper because of the half-life. So this makes it particularly good for people who you know are going to miss doses. And for some reason, the fact that it's got the longest half-life helps me remember that it's possibly got the slowest onset of action. Other things that are good to know about Prozac is that it's favored in children. It's the only antidepressant that's approved for kids 8 and older. Like I said, Lexapro is for kids 12 and older. Typically, Prozac's not necessarily first line because it didn't do as well on the meta-analysis by Cipriani, and it also has drug interactions. It's a potent CYP inhibitor, it's several CYP enzymes, so it can raise the level of a lot of drugs. So if I had to summarize Prozac in one line, I'd say it's an SSRI that hits 5-HT2C, which for some reason helps me remember that it's approved for bulimia. It's also got NET blockade, which causes it to be a little bit activating, and it's got a long half-life, and it's approved in kids and 8 and older, but it's got potent CYP inhibition. And that introduction to Prozac was provided by Tony Soprano. And I think Tony would actually be a pretty good patient for Prozac. In the show, he mentions that he was using the Prozac PRN, so you know he's going to be missing a lot of doses, so he probably would have benefited from not having to go through the discontinuation syndrome. And I also think he probably needed an SSRI that had the lowest risk of weight gain. So now the next SSRI we're going to look at is fluvoxamine, which is Luvox. So the other receptor that it hits is sigma 1, and it's FDA approved for OCD. And again, here we have the sigma enigma, and I can't help but notice that all the drugs that have the sigma receptor are pretty good for OCD. So it's usually considered an agent for anxiety and OCD, and it's not approved for depression in the United States. It's got twice daily dosing, and that's because it's got a shorter half-life of 16 hours. And just for reference, any of the drugs that I don't mention have a half-life pretty close to one day. And the other major reason Fluvox isn't used is because it's got a high risk for drug-drug interactions, and that's because it's a potent inhibitor at a few of the CYP enzymes. So if I had to give a one-liner, I'd say it's an SSRI that works pretty well for OCD, it's not approved for depression, and it's typically avoided because of the drug-drug interactions. So now that brings us to our last SSRI, which is paroxetine or Paxil. And the other receptors that it hits are M1, NET, and nitrous oxide synthetase. It's FDA approved for MDD, OCD, panic disorder, social anxiety, GAD, PTSD, PMDD, so basically alphabet soup here, and menopausal hot flashes, which it's called Brisdel. And it's used off-label for premature ejaculation. So probably the most important thing to remember for Paxil is its antimuscarinic effects. And that makes it easier to remember that it's the worst for constipation, it's got the worst sedation, and it's the worst for weight gain. And it's also probably the reason why it's got the worst discontinuation syndrome. Paxil also has inhibition at nitric oxide synthetase, and that might help explain why the sexual side effects are particularly bad for Paxil. Paxil tends to be preferred for anxiety early on, and that might have something to do with the antimuscarinic sedation. I think Paxil is bad for babies, old people, and people on medications. And the reason why I say this is because it's the most likely to cause fetal malformations. It's the only SSRI that's been linked to dementia, and that's probably because of the antimuscarinic effects. And it's also an inhibitor at CYP2D6, so that's why it's got the drug-drug interactions. So if I had to give a one-liner for Paxil, I'd say it's the SSRI with antimuscarinic side effects. It also blocks NET, but it can also be pretty problematic in that it causes birth defects, it's linked to dementia, and the 2D6 inhibition is problematic for drug-drug interactions. And it's known for a particularly bad discontinuation syndrome. So that's the last of the SSRIs that we're going to review. And now I'll quickly just go over the one-liner for each of the drugs. Zoloft is an SSRI that blocks NET, so it works well with atypical depression. It's got an excellent safety profile and minimal interactions, especially at doses less than 150, but it tends to cause diarrhea, which we remember through squirtraline. The next one is Lexapro, and this is the purest SSRI. It's got the fewest side effects and least interactions. It's approved in kids that are 12 and older, but unfortunately it's got a mild QTC increase. Then we have Celexa, which is escitalopram plus that problematic R enantiomer, and it's got a little bit of antihistamine and causes more QTC problems. Then we have Prozac that our friend Tony Soprano is on. It's an SSRI that hits 5-HT2C, which helps me to remember that it's indicated in bulimia. It also blocks NET, so it's a little bit activating. It's got a long half-life, and it's approved in kids 8 and older, and it has some CYP interactions. The next one is fluvoxamine. So this is an SSRI that works well for OCD, because we know about the sigma enigma. It's not approved for depression in the US, and it's typically avoided because of the drug-drug interactions. And then the last one we have is Paxil, which is the SSRI with anticholinergic side effects. It also blocks NET, it's known to cause birth defects, it's linked to dementia, and it's got drug-drug interactions, and it's also known for a bad withdrawal. Alright, that wraps up the differences in SSRIs. Thanks for watching.